That's it, man. Game over, man. It's game over.
Oh, no tears, please. It's a waste of good suffering.
Fairly alarmed here.
Welcome to MOTN Reviews. That is Masters of the Nerdiverse Reviews, where we take some of the Nerdiverse's shiniest cinematic supernovas and we look at some that are not so brightly lit. You can always find this penitentiary of a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, iHeartRadio, and Google Play. I am, of course, your host, Mike G, and I am extremely excited to welcome to our show King of Myth's own Brent. How's it going, sir?
It's going pretty well. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely, sir. Very, very good to have you on. Now, the movie in question, for those who've actually read the title of this episode, have an idea of what we may be talking about for this show, which is Stephen King written, Frank Darabont directed, The Green Mile. Ooh, spooky. What would you say is your history with this film? Did you read the books? Is this something
I've only had passing knowledge of the book.
Same here. Like, I know it exists. You know what I mean? Like, I knew it's like one of those things where when I was a kid, I would read a lot of Stephen King. I read It when I was a child, and then I graduated to The Stand, and then I read Nightmares and Dreamscapes. But, you know, the Green Mile was a little too mature for me when I was a kid. And by the time I got out of my Stephen King phase, I just never had a chance to read it. But, you know, I did see the movie, though. What is your history with the movie? How many times have you seen it? A million? Twice?
I can't count the number of times I've seen the movie. I've seen it so many times where I can just play the whole thing in my head.
It's one of those. That's awesome. Absolutely. Absolutely. So with this film, I literally just started watching it again before we recorded, just to re-familiarize myself with kind of the tone of the movie. And I'm not sure how you feel about it, but to me, it feels like it's almost two sides of a coin. You know what I mean? Where it's almost fantasy, but it's steeped in realism.
Sorry, go on.
Go for it.
I was going to say, this is one of the most, like, un-Stephen King things. It's, like, up there with Shawshank Redemption.
Yes.
But if you did not know the history of this movie, you would never assume this had anything to do with the man.
No, and it's this whole film, even down to its actors, it's very kind of, like, not suited for who they were. Like, even, like, Tom Hanks as the main character, you know, he's a comedian. You know, that's how he started. But he plays this role so amazingly straight that it kind of harkens back to Stephen King being more of a horror writer, a suspense writer, to writing this soulful, almost whimsical story about the impossible.
The thing about Green Mile is, like, it's an adult version of kind of a C.S. Lewis thing. It's very, like, Christian overtones.
Yes.
Very, like, paralleled Journey of Jesus thing with John Coffey.
Yes, absolutely. And it kind of keeps you, it throws you for a loop. Like you said, sometimes it feels like it was directed by Steven Spielberg, and sometimes it's like directed by like David Cronenberg. You know what I mean? It's the film constantly keeps flip-flopping about how you feel inside. You know what I mean? It's like sometimes you feel like excited when you're watching it, and certain times you feel terrified or kind of disgusted, because the characters, this is more of like an ensemble kind of cast, I would say. And I forgot how many stars are in this movie.
Oh yeah, this movie has
this
list of amazing actors. And you know, some movies are like, okay, this would have been better if they changed this person or this person, but no, I don't think anyone would ever change anybody in this list of people as these actors and who they played. I could not imagine anyone else playing John Coffey besides Michael Clark Duncan.
Yes. Or Tom Hanks, for that matter. I didn't know that Sam Rockwell was in this movie.
Yeah, there's just so many big people in this movie, and the chemistry between all of them. Like, this is the first time Tom Hanks and Michael Clark Duncan ever were in a movie together. And yes. This them in screen, like, they would have this history of each other, you would assume, just how comfortable they are.
Yes. And that's one thing about this film that I love, is that it's effortless. It's like breathing in fresh air. You know what I mean? Like, everybody is just so natural in their roles. Even the despicable characters in this film are naturally despicable. It's like nothing feels forced, especially the relationship between the Tom Hanks and Michael Clark Duncan's characters in this movie. And it just, it gives a air of realism to, like you said, this Lewis Carroll type fantasy, really. Because I was just sitting here thinking, one of the questions I want to ask you is, how would you classify this movie?
I would never say it's a horror. I would never classify as that. I would classify it as like a non-fictional light fantasy.
Yes, because it's not a drama.
No, it's not a drama, but it does use drama elements. I don't know if it's like the screenwriter or the director or whatever Stephen King put in the book, but like the way it pirouettes and twists the tone of the story, because you have that like beginning of the movie where you have John Coffey holding these dead girls in his arms and he's covered in blood.
Yes.
And then you have the little moments in the cells that totally breaks up this serious mood, when you have like the going through the process of killing people, and you have the janitor making up those jokes and freaking that he's dying, and just it does so good changing the tone of the story each and every moment when it needs to, and you don't expect it.
Absolutely. And it just feels like there's a bunch of mini movies inside this movie. You know what I mean? Like you were saying, like the dichotomy from John Coffey holding the twin girls, and that scene of the I hate to say lynching squad running through the amber waves of grain to find him in this poster shot of him screaming at the top of his lungs. But then you transition to Mr. Jangles, you know what I mean? You know, doing his effects trick, and it just lightens you up. Like, this film keeps you on your toes, like, emotionally, you know, not even with any kind of intense action scenes or anything visually stimulating. It's all like feeling. It's a very, very, I would say, emotionally jarring movie, but in the best way possible.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
And then I feel like it does something that every movie tries to invoke, but very few do. And that's instant investigation to a character. You're instantly invested into Tom Hanks' character. I can't remember his character's name in this movie.
Paul?
Yes.
Paul, I think.
Yeah. And you're instantly invested into his two buddy guards, like the really burly one that's the tough, silent one, but he's got a heart of gold. And then the more quiet one that's the more logical of the two.
Yes. And there's the older gentleman who's kind of simple, but he's very to the point.
And he's not very much in the movie.
Yeah, he's like, he pissed on my shoe.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, he just acknowledges it. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay.
Yeah, like, you know. I love when he's on the screen, but he's like more in the background. Like, he's never much in the face.
Right. He plays his part very well, to where he rounds out that trio. You know what I mean? And like you were mentioning with Paul, you're automatically invested in him. And I forgot about the beginning of this movie, where it takes place in quote unquote modern times, where it starts off at the resting home.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? For a second, I was like, I completely forgot this was part of the movie. I was like, am I watching The Green Mile?
Yeah. The way it opens is so weird, because then again, that little pirouette, like, hey, you have these old people. It's okay. Let me tell you my story. And then it opens up with John Coffey holding these dead baby girls in his arms. You're like, okay, what did I just get into?
Yeah, it's really a punch to the gut, you know? And, you know, they're watching like Maury Povich or something like that. They're watching Jerry Springer. And then it codes opens to Paul and you immediately start feeling for him, because at the time he was like, I had the worst bladder infection in my entire life. Mm-hmm. You see him struggling through that throughout the first half of the film, and it automatically makes you feel for him, especially when you start to realize that he's a legit good man.
Yeah, and
you know what I mean? Like,
and the thing about this movie is it loves to get that carpet underneath you and then just fling it.
Yeah, because it introduces other factors that throw you off kilter again, like Percy, the overexcited new guard, I would say, who kind of throws a monkey wrench in their harmonious kind of, like you said, almost religious approach to being the men who get to see men who ferry men to death.
Yeah, they're the keepers.
They almost feel like, exactly. It doesn't feel like a prison. The only time it feels like a prison is like at the beginning of the film, where they're literally doing a chain gang, and you see them during the Great Depression, you know, working the fields, like the rest of the general population. But once you're on the Green Mile, it almost feels like a monastery. Does that make sense? It doesn't feel like everyone has their role, and everybody's very,
they're respectful. Very tempered. It's very a respectful place. They don't have any issues with the people on there. They almost have like a bond, especially with very certain cellmates. Like, you know, the whole thing with Mr. Jangles and how they were going to say, yeah, we'll take care of your mouse. He's going to go to Mouseland. He's going to have a very good mm-hmm. life. And then Percy just destroys that. And this would bring up to my topic I want to bring up with this movie. This movie knows how to play its viewer. It knows how to invoke things from you. And it goes, oh, you remember John Coffey and how he showed him with these girls? You thought you were going to hate him. No, he's a big teddy bear. Let us show you Percy. Yeah. And you think, I'll never hate anyone more than Percy. I'll never want to choke anyone more than Percy. And then you get Wild Bill.
Exactly. And that's the thing. It keeps you off kilter with this harmonious place, it's almost like the River Styx, the Green Mile is, but you keep introducing bad person, let's say bad influence, then worse influence. You know what I mean? And it constantly keeps you off your balance. Percy was the beginning of that as the troublemaker / entitled rich kid who's doing this for whatever sadistic kicks that he has. And then you're introduced, which is one of my favorite movie character introductions in cinema, is the introduction of Wild Bill, played by Sam Rockwell, who, if this man does not win an Oscar by the end of his career, I'm just going to throw a flaming bow and arrow, you know, into like Universal. Like, he's just too good. He's too good of an actor.
I think, personally, the introduction of John Coffey overshadows the introduction of Wild Bill, because it's this zoomed out, you see this truck come in, the bottom almost scraping the ground, you're like, what's in there? Like a couple like horses or something. And then you see like four or five guards come out, and this mountain of,
you know,
a man.
And it kind, and it sets you up. Like, if unfortunately nowadays everybody knows the gag, right? Everybody knows that, you know, John Coffey is a mountain with a heart of gold, you know, but for those who saw this for the first time, probably had no real inkling to the level of almost kind of weird perfection that John Coffey represents, a simple perfection, you know, whereas Wild Bill, it's levels of his character development. You know, first he's playing that you don't know this at the time, but he's playing that he's so doped up that he's just gone. He's not blinking. He's completely kind of active comatose. But then the more you see him on screen, the more he starts to peel back his intention, to the point where he does do, where he pretty much jumps the entire guard group by himself, chained. You know what I mean? And it's just one of those, I love the development. It was almost like a stage play, his introduction was. But yeah, John Coffey's intro carries weight because it's a metaphor for the whole film. Like, don't judge, like, you're judging someone off their looks and not the content of the character, funny enough. You know what I mean? Absolutely. So there's a lot of wrinkles in this film that just kind of that give it its personality. One that comes to mind is when Paul is starting to get second thoughts about John Coffey's actual guilt, if he's actually guilty, and he visits Gary Sinise at his house, and Gary Sinise tells him the story about the dog and his son. And it's just this tone breaker, you know what I mean? Where at this point, the film has been kind of light in, not necessarily light, but it's been kind of by the numbers. They show you the process of how a man dies, like you mentioned earlier, Mr. Jangles and all that fun stuff. But when it gets to Gary Sinise's house, it kind of reminds you of the time that this is taking place in the mind state of your average person back then. We're not your average person, but you know what I mean, of the local folk, unfortunately. And it just kind of just brings you back down to the severity of the situation. Like, this is how they feel. Like, you know, a dog, you know, like he's mentioned, a dog can be nice to you, love you for years, but one day it just may snap. And that was their idea of how African Americans were. That's pretty much what he laid down and showed his son, who had his eye taken by a dog. He was like, you can't let him out of your sight once, or let your guard down once, because it's going to happen. It's a matter of time. And it didn't seem to really affect Paul at all. Paul's just like, whatever. it didn't change his way that he treated John after that. In fact, it endeared him more to John, because at the next scene, he brought him some cornbread for his wife. You know what I mean? Which opened John up more. And the French inmate
it also kind of cemented the fact that Paul is a good person. Like, you've been shown that he's a very responsible man who makes sure that he gets his job done. But you also see in depth that he is a man that has deep morals, and that he will not let the times or what people think is right decide what he thinks is right.
And it's really just a showcase of Paul's mettle. You know what I mean? Those scenes those scenes set together. You know what I mean? It's a hard cut to him saying, "Hey, John, my wife made you some cornbread to thank you for helping me out." Wink, wink. And just one scene that I remember that really caught my mind was the scene of Percy kind of in the mirror grooming himself, but then you see the picture of the mouse grooming itself, and it's like this weird metaphor. You know, it's a beautifully done shot. And that's when Percy loses it and tries to kill the mouse, but he's definitely thwarted and taught a lesson, which he never learns. Percy never quite learns his lesson. Mm-mm. And that's just, I guess that's a moral of it all into itself. Now,
do you want to talk a little bit about the cinematography of this movie and just how artfully and masterfully it's done?
Are you familiar with Stanley Kubrick films? You know what I mean? Like Barry Lyndon, 2001 Space Odyssey, The Shining. Yeah. Kind of rivals that cinematography. Just on, like you mentioned, the scene where John Coffey is with the two girls. You know what I mean? It's shot perfectly. He's dead center of the shot. It's like a painting almost, with the backdrop of the woods and people closing in on him. It's horrifyingly beautiful in a weird way, if that makes any sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's one of those things where you can take these key frames of the movie and putting these side by side will kind of tell the story. Because you'll have the thing with John Coffey coming off the thing, the four men leading him down the hall. You can like slide these side by side and go, this is the story.
You can take a good probably 10 shots from this film and pretty much spell it out. Not even that, 5 shots. You know what I mean? Because they're just so iconic and so well placed. You know what I mean? The shot of him healing the warden's wife. You know what I mean? Like, it's mind blowing.
Actually, if you'd like to talk a little bit about the book there, that's actually something I do know. The thing with the warden's wife is a bit different. Like, she just goes ballistic on him, calls him all sorts of things. It's a very invoking and powerful scene in the book. And I feel like they do still come across that in the movie. It's just a little bit more oomph to it in the book. But I literally like how well this movie stuck to the book. And from people I've talked to who read it, like, it's like 90 to 80% there.
And I think that's the biggest challenge for adapting a book. That's the toughest part. Because it's like, you know, there's not enough film to get it exactly right. But I think most authors are happy if you can get the spirit of the book. But very rarely do you get both, you know, where they capture the spirit of what King was trying to depict. But they also have so many shots, they get it just right, that it's one of those few films that are praised for its accuracy to the novel. You know what I mean? And that's, like you said, a very rare thing to capture, especially now where Hollywood is just cutting all the corners. I did want to ask you a question, though. Do you believe that John's powers were actually real, or were they hyperbole by Paul in his later years?
I believe they were real, because you have the proof of how old Paul is. Like, I think he actually shows a scene with his wife, Gravestone or something of that nature. Like, he gives solid proof of how old he is. I can't remember exactly that proof is. My memory is blanking, but he's like, yeah, this is how old I am. And people just don't live that
like,
old.
Think about it. Like, they were watching Jerry Springer on a color TV, and he was, he may have been 30, 40 years old in the Great Depression, which was what, 1920s?
Mm-hmm. 1910s? Like 1925.
Around there, right?
It's around there.
So he had to be pushing, quick math, like, you know, 90, 100. I'm just kidding. But,
yeah, he's around like 110, I believe, is what he
says. And he's taking giant long walks into the forests, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Every day. You know what I mean? So.
And he's as sharp as a tack, too. Like, his mind's completely
He remembers the
solid.
Song and starts crying. You know what I mean? Like, he's completely there. The oldest man probably at that resting home. So, you could say that John gave him kind of the Midas touch, as it were, a little bit. So, I think that is actually very good proof to the validity of the miracles, I want to call them, regarding John Coffey. Now, is there anything before we get to the actual end of the story that you wanted to cover in regards to kind of where we are here? I would say,
I would like to talk about one of the first instances of this like movie actually being a Stephen King influence. There is one specific piece of this story that will tell you this is King. And that's when Coffey uses his powers and he heals Paul, and he expels these like locust-like things, and that moment makes me go, okay, this is how it's King.
And there's another moment I want to talk about actually too that kind of reminds you who the author is. But yeah, it makes me think that at first I was thinking, is John Coffey more like a sin eater? You ever heard that expression before, where he kind of takes on the ailments of others and dispels it through himself? But
Yeah, sin eater.
So I was thinking, like, maybe that's the case, but he doesn't really carry the pain with him. He immediately expels it, kind of like with the resurrection of Mr. Jangles, you know. But then again, when the Frenchman got, you know, that's the scene I wanted to talk about, how dark that was in the movie. When he's going through his electrocution, John is feeling it the entire time. Which makes me think that maybe he's more of an empathic healer, if that makes any sense to you. Kind of like,
yeah,
where he feels the pain. Like, someone touches him, he can kind of read their entire kind of history. You know what I mean? Like, or read their intentions, rather. I wouldn't say necessarily.
Yeah, that was shown with like the whole Wild Bill scene when he touched Wild Bill.
He's just, you're a bad man. You know what I mean? And when he touched Paul, he had no adverse reaction. You know what I mean? Because that initial handshake, he probably got all he needed to know from Paul to know, oh, okay, he's okay. I see he's in pain. I'm going to help him, which is the scene where Paul literally is on the ground, just paralyzed by his pain. And John is constantly the entire day kind of saying, hey, come over here. He's like, not right now. He's like, I need to talk to you. But the scene that reminds me that this is a Stephen King film is the electrocution scene, where Percy kind of does the worst thing humanly possible and doesn't give this guy the right send-off by not soaking the sponge before execution, which turns him into like a heavy metal album cover. You know what I mean? It's
I'd also like to tie in here that one of the topic we covered earlier, how Percy is a perversion of everything that's going on and before, and how he basically twists and almost brings it to like the polar opposite of how it was before. And this scene is kind of the crescendo of that.
Percy lays seeds of just the wrong way to do it. Like you said, he is kind of the poster child for a perversion of the purity that they hold this station with such regard. You know what I mean? They're extremely nice to their patrons. Even when Wild Bill spits in Paul's face, he's like, okay, you get one, just letting you know, the next one will cost you. You know what I mean? They're so patient with everyone. They're so respectful. But then you have Percy, who's very much the opposite. You know what I mean? He's disrespectful to his own team. He's constantly berating and physically abusing the other inmates. You know what I mean? Because he has a higher than thou, no one can touch me because of who I know kind of mentality, which I'm sure ran rapid around that time and honestly runs rapid nowadays. But and that electrocution scene, like you said, is the nail on the head and kind of the climax, I would say. Would you say that's the climax of the film? No?
No, the climax of the film is the death of Coffee.
That's definitely the, I would say. But this is kind of like, that's what makes this film so crazy, because I want to give it a higher regard because it was so jarring. Like, you could just hear people describe the smell of the room, and he literally just burst into blue flames, you know, and tears into charred ash in his chair. And not before nor after do you see such acts of horrific body horror in the film. You know what I mean?
And then besides the locust, this goes, hey, remember who the title author of this is? Yeah.
Here you go. Don't sleep. Stephen King will find ways to freak you out. Please understand. You know what I mean? And that scene stuck with me when I first saw it, kind of when I was younger. I was like, wow, like that's all it takes, huh? And it makes sense. You know, it makes absolute sense. And
it also kind of seems like Green Mile is a weird movie, because in most movies you have a clear antagonist or a person who is going against your protagonist. In Green Mile, you never get 100%, hey, this is the protagonist. You have a POV person being Paul, but you also are kind of like split between Paul, John Coffey, his two real good buddies, and the others on the mile. You never get 100%, this is the person that you need to think of as the hero of the movie.
Exactly. There's, like you said, they're villains, mind you. There's antagonists towards, I couldn't even say that, because this is really a story of John Coffey, of his stay at the Green Mile, and there are characters that are kind of sprinkled around it. May they be malevolent or benevolent. I can't, my tongue twister.
It's a very much a full cast crew. Everyone has to be in their part. It's a very much ensemble deal. Everyone has to be there for this to make sense. And you don't really have a overall antagonist. You have these people who kind of stand in the way and represent the forces of evil in this world that Coffee kind of is there to combat.
Right. He's kind of the, like you said, as for the spirit, the religious allegory, he's the unspotted lamb for that needs to be sacrificed for the greater good of man, right? And no matter,
And then you get that emotional depth where he's like, "I'm tired, boss.
Yeah,
put me down.
Put me
boss.
Down. I'm so tired." You know what I mean? And it just hits you right in the gut, because you know, like, an innocent man is frying and an innocent man is dying, but he's lives. I guess he lives his life to the best ability that he could, given his station, and he kind of fulfilled his destiny.
Well, also, like, hearing him talk, like, when he's talking about, like, the evil intentions of the world, like, it's like glass being put into your eyes, just these evil thoughts, and this world is just so much hurt, people being angry at each other
that's
for no reason.
That's super rough, man. That's one part I didn't get to from my rewatching, but I just kind of vaguely remember, like his final piece, You know what I mean? Like him having a moment to really act. You know, Michael Clark Duncan has been quite very, very tight spoken through the whole film, kind of having moments here and there. That smells like cornbread. You know what I mean? Like, I'm tired. He just kind of turns over and goes to sleep. But
then again, the movie just pirouettes and just grabs you and goes, ha ha! And it shows you John Coffey having his last request watching this movie. And this him watching this musical and having a good time. And this seeing this pure giant man having this, like, situation that he would never be able to experience before, where he's and at peace.
It's like you said, it just shifts. It shifts the tone of how you're feeling to pure joy as you see him having a pure joy moment and the guards just relishing in his joy. You know what I mean? As he's just having a ball watching Top Hat. You know what I mean? Until his actual execution. You know what I mean?
And then that scene directly makes the punch, which would have been like a punch to the gut, into a haymaker that knocks you out, because he hums and sings that song while they're placing the hood and the metal on his head. And he go, place the hood, and like, no, boss, please don't do
that's
that.
That's rough.
I'm afraid of the dark.
It reminds me of Iron.
And then you just get that clean, the strike to your jaw. Like, I'm done.
I'm mostly checked out. And that's why you understand, and it takes you all the way back to the beginning of the movie and understand the weight that that song holds still on Paul to this day. You know what I mean? Like, how would you forget that ever? If you were in Paul's shoes, you know what I mean? That would be burned into your psyche forever, right? Like, there's no way. There's absolutely no way.
Mm-hmm. And then, like, going back to my allegory of this being a religious tones, that same setting where he's talking to Coffey about his last wishes, you go, do you want me to let you out? Do you want me to let you run? We can get you out of here. You can be free. And he's like, why wouldn't you do something so foolish? Because when I die, I don't want to stand in front of God the Father and go, I killed the perfect creation that you put on this planet for us.
Talk about... that's just heavy. You saying that just kind of knocked the wind out of me a little bit. Just that idea of having that kind of weight on your chest to say, I don't want to be the one, you know, like I don't want to be the one that uses the spear of Longinus and deals the killing blow to such a perfect being, I would say. Not perfect, but pure. Just a pure being that John Coffey represents. And Paul's like, I just can't do it. Like, I will risk it all.
But then he appeals to Paul, because Paul is a good man. Mm-hmm. And he's like, please, boss, I'm tired.
Oh, man. Then, of course, the execution goes off without a hitch. Percy is put into a like, not a necessarily correctional facility, but he was put into, like, an institution, wasn't he?
Oh, he was driven insane because of the final act of Coffey, when he had that evilness inside him from Wild Bill, and he put inside Percy, and he shot Wild Bill. Again, I don't know, like, if that was Coffey's attention, or if it's just how that stuff works. I don't know. I never read the book, so I don't know if that's explained more in the book or what that stuff actually is.
If I remember correctly, when Wild Bill touched Coffey, he never expelled whatever he pulled from him, so it had to go somewhere. He was keeping it in.
He didn't expel it.
And maybe there are moments in this film where John does show some levels of precognition. You know what I mean? Especially when he's talking about the lady in the wheelchair, when he's looking up at the stars, or when he's telling him to be careful in the introduction of Wild Bill. So he could have already had, it may have been an ulterior motive for John to, this is the only way that Percy's going to get his comeuppance. You know what I mean? Or a tune for his sins, especially towards the French inmate that he pretty much completely unnecessarily tortured to death, pretty much, you know? So I hate to say if it was John's intention, because that kind of puts a blemish on his perfect spirit, but maybe which is something like, well, I have to expel this anyway. It has to go somewhere. It's not necessarily an illness. It's more of an intent. And maybe intent works different than illness. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's really hard to say what this stuff is because it's never given a name. It's never talked about. Maybe it's just like corruption incarnate. Would be a good way to describe it.
It dissipates into the air like dandelion spores. Like, it's not necessarily like you were mentioning earlier, it being like locusts or flies or anything. It comes out like that. But once it starts to kind of dissipate, it almost becomes like ash. You know what I mean? It kind of. But with Wild Bill, it didn't work that way. Maybe because it was a different kind of corruption. It was a.
Or how intense it was, because he was a truly
He was a wild dog. Man. You know what I mean? He just had, there was no redeeming qualities to Wild Bill. Mm. You know what I mean? At all. He's a bit of a jokester, you know, but at the same time, we're never really given a full scope of what exactly Wild Bill did, or any of the inmates for that matter, now that I think about it. You know what I mean?
And we're told actually what every inmate did. The Frenchman burnt down a building.
I missed that. I totally missed that. What did the?
And in the book, everyone did it. But also, they talked about it a little bit in the movie. I think it's mentioned once or twice. But yeah, the Frenchman burnt down an apartment building and accidentally killed somebody. Wild Bill's is shown. Coffee's is of course framed for Wild Bill. The other one is the Native American man at the beginning.
The first execution. I remember him talking about, he was talking about like how when he was young, he would like hang out with his old lady in the moonlight. And that's pretty much the furthest he got into his backstory before he was the first execution. You know what I mean?
Can't remember what he did.
But yeah. You know what I mean? For Paul, in kind of like the end of his story, it kind of shows, like you said, I've been reading the notes here, and it shows that Paul was actually 108 years old, which is
108, nutty, okay.
And that they were showing that, like, to your testament that this was actually happening, Mr. Bojangles was just as alive as Paul was. And that's where he was going off to go see, Mr. Jangles in that little cottage or whatever, I believe it was.
Yeah, and he still did the trick and all that,
You know what I mean? That just goes to show the power of John and how it kind of blessed these two creatures and countless others, whoever he crossed his path before he came to the Green Mile.
And like, and the part where Paul's talking about, like, if he can make a mouse live so long, how long do you think I'm going to be cursed to walk this earth?
That's a sequel all into itself. I want Paul to be in the year 2525, and it's like an abandoned wasteland. And he's like walking with Mr. Jangles on his shoulder, and he's wearing like a giant Mad Max shoulder pads.
Well, speaking of Mr. Jangles, that's like to me segue into the actually final scene of the movie where it starts to black out and go to the credits. You know how it's like showing Mr. Jangles in his little bed? He actually stops breathing and passes.
Wow, I didn't catch that. That's nutty. So a mouse that should have naturally died many times over. Yeah.
Like a year.
Lived that for that long with a natural lifespan. How long is Paul going to live? Right? Like 200, 300 years old. But his body continues to age. So that could be a curse all into itself, dude. You want to be 300 years old, trapped in the body of a 300-year-old man, but have the, you know?
Or his body plateau. We don't know. Like, we don't know if like his body plateaued at an old body. Because, again, he's pretty dexterous.
He's running around. He's climbing mountains and stuff. You know what I mean? You know, he's climbing trails. Nobody has to worry about in the rain. He's doing all types of cool stuff. You know what I mean? So that's the film. That's the Green Mile. This is a movie I haven't watched in so many years. I watched this back when I was a child, and it just captured my imagination. And now watching it again as an adult, so many things that kind of stand out in context, and just I'm at a loss to label this movie. Like you said, it's not horror. It's not a drama. It's almost like it's fantasy, but it's not. It's like modern fantasy. You know what I mean? Like,
it's a potpourri. It's a little bit of everything, and it uses everything.
I like that. I think that's going to be the hook for the show. That's that.
But no, like, whenever anyone asks me about my top movies, I go, top three? Easy. Green Mile, Shawshank Redemption, and I can't... My third one always kind of rotates depending on, like, what my mood is, but my top two...
So you're a Frank Darabont man, dude. Yeah, man.
Is this the timelessness of these? Oh, third one, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure.
Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, my bad. Yeah, Willy Wonka, because Charlie's the new one, my bad.
With
Johnny Depp, no, but Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Just the timelessness of them. You can play these movies, you know, 100 years from now, and they'll still just be as relevant as they are today.
Now, I'm just curious. Have you ever had a chance to watch Frank Darabont's The Mist, that film?
Yeah. Oh, I did see The Mist, but it's been such a long time since I've seen it. I vaguely only remember parts.
That's
of
another
it.
One that you can watch 100 years from now and be like, yeah, that's pretty rough. For this film, since it's your top three of all time, I dare ask, what would you rate it on a scale from 0 to 5? Zero being complete trash, five being
solid five.
Best things is solid five, huh? It's hard to argue that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
It's hard to pick a movie that just does its subject matter better, has a more compensative cast that it's so comfortable with, and they're all comfortable with each other. Because we've seen what happens when you have people try to act in a movie that don't have chemistry. Like, I'd like to point out of the fourth Indiana Jones movie with the Crystal Skull.
Mm-hmm. Yikes. And... it's like, I want it to be just, a part of me wanted to be a contrarian and be like, oh, 4.5. But it's like, I can't find anything to pick at it against. The casting is immaculate. The storytelling is tight. It keeps you on the edge of your seat without making you feel anxiety. You know what I mean? It's like, everyone on that mile is going to die. But the movie gives you a sense of hope, weirdly. In that these men have atoned for their sins, that are going on to the next adventure. Even John Coffey, you know what I mean, is begging for death towards the end of this film. Not begging, but
well, he kind of is. And I like to compare this movie to like kind of like a tough Southern mother. She'll baby you, she'll take care of you, but she'll whip you when you need it.
Exactly. Thank you. That's good. In this movie. Hits you upside the head every once in a while to remind you of the severity of the situation. But then after that, it kind of lays you back down in a warm bath. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for every John Coffey death or Frenchman death, you have the purity of John Coffey watching that movie. You have the interactions with Paul and Coffey, or the interactions of everyone on the mile when Percy's not there.
Yes. And there's a blimp in the movie where Percy's just gone. For a split second, and everything's kind of, it reminds you how balanced this ecosystem is. You know what I mean? Even with Wild Bill, Wild Bill is kind of the placeholder for Percy when he's not there, but even he has his own checks and balances, like the whole moon pie scene, where they just immediately shoot him back into the padded room where he's literally going insane. Mm-hmm. You know, there's still checks and balances, and it's still enough to keep you, to keep you on your toes. Because it's like, why does he want that moon pie? Why is he just shoving it down his throat? And then you're like, oh, that's clever. But then it doesn't let you stay comfortable. You know what I mean? And that's the great thing about this movie. Even the scenes with Paul and his wife, they're very sweet. And I forget the actress's name, but she plays that role for the scenes that she does have very well.
Mm-hmm. Again, the chemistry. You know
what I mean? She's kind of, the chemistry is extremely good. And you could tell that they're a seasoned married couple. You know what I mean? They just feel broke. It feels so broken in. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, there's no awkward pauses. Everything kind of flows. And even when he's feeling better and they have their infinite night of pleasures, you know what I mean? She's like, what's up with you? Like, something's, this isn't normal. What's wrong with you? You know what I mean? And then he kind of spills the beans about it. It's just the whole movie itself is, like you said, it's kind of like, it's like banana bread, but every once in a while you bite into a walnut. You're like, oh, okay. You continue with your banana bread.
This movie has something I like to call the three C's of movies: cast, cinema, and cinematography.
Well, hey.
Yes, that, you cast, chemistry, and cinematography.
Yeah, and that's what it has. You know, it also has cast, chemistry, and cinematography. Alien.
In much a different sense. It's a much a different sense, the way that invoke things. That's much more cinematography to invoke things, but it has all those. It's really interesting in the way that these three things can be interchanged.
Yes, they can. It's 30, 60, 90, and the 10% is just that lightning in a bottle. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? And sometimes that 10% can take a movie that is not that great and make it amazing. Like Die Hard. Mm-hmm. No, I'm just kidding, Die Hard. Don't come at me, fans. Die Hard is amazing. I will not talk about one of my favorite Christmas movies of all time.
I love that. It's a Christmas movie. It makes me so happy.
It makes me so happy. I watch it every Christmas and people wonder why I'm weird. Oh, man. This is a great movie. And to give my score, everybody, I have to echo Brant here. It's a 5 out of 5. It's one of those movies that you show classes to teach people how to arrange films. How good films could be and what kind of lessons they can teach. It's just one of those perfect movies. I can't really find any flaws, nor that I'm looking for them, because the movie just makes you feel good. It keeps you on the edge of your seat and it teaches you lessons. So 5 out of 5 for me. Absolutely. Where can we find you?
Well, you can find me on Twitter at KingofMyths1. And I am be putting together my own little podcast that will be called Nerds with the Oblong Table.
Yeah. Yeah, cannot wait for that. Give me the elevator pitch for Nerds of the Oblong Table. What's it all about? This so our listeners can get on it once it's ready.
Well, it's basically we're going to be talking about nerd culture with a group of people that I can put together. So far, I've only had, I think, one or two, but we're just going to be talking about everything that is relevant to nerds. The first episode that I want to talk about is the do's and do nots of being a GM and a DM.
Nice. Interesting. That's some D&D lingo right there, isn't
it? DM as for Dungeon Master.
Spicy. And GM as in Game Master?
Yeah, Game Master is not strictly for Dungeons & Dragons. That's basically anyone who runs a game in any system.
Oh, cool. See, I don't know much about D&D other than I really want to get into it. And I would love to hear that first episode, kind of as a precursor to my own infancy into sticking my pinky toe into the waters and making my elf rogue named Gargon, who has purple hair. Yes, this is my OC. Don't shame him, please.
That's fine. It's fine. If you have any questions of this, please just send them my way. I've been DMing for 14 years, so I have run
Sweet.
The gambit.
I cannot wait to hear that, my good sir. And if you like more content like this, please let us know on our Twitter. That is at MNerdiverse, where we are growing our Nerdiverse by the day. I do daily polls. I ask questions. We all have a good time. There's Punch and Pie, digital Punch and Pie, but Punch and Pie nonetheless. And if you like this podcast, no matter how you're listening to it, on iTunes, on Stitcher, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, iHeartRadio, Google Play, please, if you like it, like it. If you want to give us some input, comment, and as always, it'll be great if you subscribe. I, of course, been your host, Mike G, and I will always ask you to look towards the skies. Look towards the skies.